All right, ladies and gentlemen, the final session at Unicorns of India track is particularly pivotal for founders and founders to be, because our speakers are going to talk about building and scaling companies, what founders need to keep in mind. Well, I'm going to be warmly and happily inviting Manoj Kohli, the country head, SoftBank India, SoftBank Group International, who will be in conversation with. Of course, you have been witnessing a lot of chats, but right now for this session, once again, and we'll be joined by our moderator, Vinod Mahanta, the senior editor from the Economic Times. So with that, it's over to you two gentlemen.
Thanks, Shikha. Let me start with a question which is very relevant in these uncertain times. The COVID-19 has been a black swan event. It has created a lot of havoc in companies. The shift in consumer demand was unprecedented in these times. So the big question was, there were companies which were facing demand collapse, there were companies which were seeing a spike in demand. How do entrepreneurs build companies which are resilient enough to handle these shocks?
Thank you, Vinod. I think this period of 18 to 20 months has been unprecedented in global history last century. I think the technology small, medium towns, even villages are adopting the digital technology, digital transactions, payment, and online shopping, etc. That has been a major upside. Of course, there have been many problems with the masses of people, especially lower strata of society. But at the same time, there are companies who have adopted digitization as a mantra. I think the digitization process would have taken about a decade, what has happened in the last 18 months. So there has been a leap of consumer behavior, which is fantastic. And I feel that future digitization now will be catalyzed very strongly. Companies who adopt it wholeheartedly, end-to-end, will be victorious. Companies who are still hesitant, I think, will have to struggle in times to come. Now, entrepreneurs who have been resilient, have looked at long-term, have looked at processes, have looked at automation, have looked at innovation engine being stronger and stronger with new products and new services, new features. And also entrepreneurs who have looked at frugality for lower break-evens have been victorious. And I think these attitudes are very, very good attitudes of middle-class, hungry entrepreneurs of India, young boys and girls who are maybe 25, 27, 30. They're doing a fantastic job.
One of the interesting debates that has been on in the Indian startup segment is basically this whole growth versus profitability debate. If you see the top unicorns, even 90% of them are not making profits. They have the right product, they have a big addressable market, they have funds in place, but profitability seems to be elusive. Where do you stand on this growth versus profitability debate?
No, it is not growth versus profitability, it is growth and profit. Both have to be achieved by every enterprise. It is very, very clear that growth without profitability has no value. Similarly, just profitability and no growth or low growth also doesn't have too much value. So all entrepreneurs have to balance themselves. Now, we also have to remember that every period, every business has a gestation period. A gestation period could be 2 years, 3 years. Some businesses could be sooner, 1 year, where you break even and then start slowly making profits. Every business, whether it's brick and mortar, whether it's chemicals, telecom, any business. Same applies to the startups. So my advice to all the entrepreneurs whenever I interact with them is that the growth has to be a controlled growth. By that, I mean that growth which doesn't encourage wastage of resources. Growth where you control all the aspects of quality, reliability, customer satisfaction, etc. Growth, just like when you drive a car, if you drive at 60 or 80, you can control it and stop it whenever you want to. Maybe if you drive at 100 or 120, it's out of control. So I always advise the entrepreneurs, drive the car till a point you control it. You control the steering wheel. Once you don't control it, then there'll be a lot of wastage, there'll be a lot of burnout of people, there'll be a lot of side effects which are not good for the business. And if you do that, if you drive it in a balanced way, in a controlled way, then break-even will happen faster, profitability will happen faster. And even if it starts small, where your profits are only 1% or 2% or 5%, that is okay. But it will start if you control the growth, if you manage the growth systematically.
One of the things that I'm seeing in the Indian startup scene is that people have the funding going on. Their operating model is right. They're solving a problem. But very few companies, very few startups are focusing on creating a culture. I mean, Drucker used to say culture eats strategy for breakfast. I mean, how do you create a winning culture? It's not just about money, product, but culture is the important part.
Vinod, you are so right, because culture does eat strategy for breakfast. It's very, very important that we create a high performance culture in every startup. And luckily for us, for India, I think entrepreneurs and founders are focusing on that now. Maybe earlier they were not, but now they are definitely focusing. In the last 18 months, I've seen a change in behavior, because empathy is there, performance orientation is there. So it is very, very clear that culture, a good culture, will sustain your performance over a long, long time. It's not a short-term phenomenon. I remember my Airtel days when we created a very high performance culture in Airtel. And even today, you see Airtel is doing well in the marketplace, is sustaining cutthroat competition and doing well. And primarily, I will give the credit to good high performance culture, where people are respected, where people are listened to, there is empathy. There is also a very high degree of objectivity and fairness in dealing with people, dealing with performance management. Because if people know that their performance will be measured in a very objective and fair fashion and given rewards and recognitions, then people are very happy. They become owners of the business without owning a stock. Also, at Airtel, I remember we used to celebrate every win, whether it's a small victory or a big win, all victories were celebrated so that people know what to do and what not to do. So yeah, they take ownership when they know what to do and what not to do. And sometimes people used to do more than what they were empowered to, which is okay if they're doing the right thing. Sometimes they used to make mistakes, and we used to say, don't repeat mistakes and cut the cost of mistake on the same day if you come to know that it's a mistake. So people actually were very enthused, high degree of enthusiasm, high degree of ownership, high degree of focus on the goals of the company. And that is why they really gave their best passion to the growth and profitability of the company.
A lot of companies in India are basically in that stage, which is called the valley of death by technology VCs. Basically, a period from from innovation to the commercialization. A lot of people don't survive that. What are your views, basically? What should an entrepreneur do to go through that stage, survive or bypass that whole valley of death stage?
No, this valley of death is a bit harsh word. But you're right, it is a tough time when you have to validate three big things. One, you validate your product or service, whether it is good for the customer. whether it is making life of a customer easy and convenient. Whether compared to yesterday's life of customer today, if he or she feels better, more easier. If that is the first test, and that test has to be passed, and if that test is passed in the laboratory, but not passed in the market, then entrepreneur has to make some changes. The second thing is a profitable business model. How will the product or service be delivered to the customer? In the hands of the customer, whether through digital or offline or online, how will it be done, and how will it be done in a profitable way? So that every unit of sale, every unit of transaction is profitable, even if the profit is small, because as the volumes grow, economies of scale will grow, and hence per unit margin will improve. So that is the second and most important test. If the business model is not profitable, especially on per unit basis, entrepreneur has to again make some changes, very important changes. The third thing, which is also very important for entrepreneur, is continuous innovation, continuous product development, continuous new ideas, because customers are very, very highly expectant today. Their expectations from each brand, each service are very high, and they get bored very fast. So the brands have to deliver new ideas, new products, new features regularly. If they are done regularly, their loyalty to the brand is much higher. So this again, entrepreneur has to test, is the innovation engine, is the product development process in good shape, in good health? If it is there, then fine. If it's not there, then he or she has to strengthen the product development process so that new ideas are given shape for the sake of better experience of the customer. Because experience of the customer is the final test of every entrepreneur. And this so-called valley of death can be improved. The success factor can be improved if these three factors are focused upon by every founder.
One of the interesting things that I'm witnessing in the whole startup scenario is the way companies are approaching the marketplace. There are some companies which are growing very fast, acquiring companies every other day. You see an acquisition. And in the same sector, you're seeing a company which has a slow and steady way of going about a business. And studies have shown that people who have slow measured growth usually do better. Given the size of India, given the funding that is coming in, which approach do you think the company should take right now? I mean, we've had a builders which took 20 years to build in the business, and they had a massive, they had a great exit. And there are some companies which have achieved growth in that space in 2 years' time, 3 years' time. So which side are you on this debate?
It's not about slow or fast. It's about, as I said, controlled fast. Company has to adopt, and new companies luckily are doing it, has to adopt agility and speed as a mantra. Agility and speed for everything the company does, everything the team does, whether it's decision-making process, whether it is introduction of new products and services, whether it is new branding, fresh ideas, whether it is opening up new markets. So in everything company initiates, it has to adopt speed as a mantra. Now, speed mantra doesn't mean that you will go so fast, as I said earlier, that you lose control of the business. The business has to be in good health. The speed should be to that point that governance doesn't slip. Wastage doesn't happen. Many employees who are working hard should not be worn out, should not actually be burnt out. So that optimization of speed is the job of a founder. Founder has to keep his or her ear close to the ground. Sometimes he or she may feel that speed is too much, so let me slow down a bit. Sometimes he or she may feel speed is too slow. Maybe decision making is slow. Maybe analysis is too much. So then he or she has to speed up the process. So this is not a one-time activity. It's a continuous activity of measuring the speed of company's growth with the capability of the team. Because team capability, team maturity is very important. If the team is not that capable or mature, then the speed will be low. But if the team is capable and also bonded with each other, then the speed will be very high. So these are the factors every founder has to monitor very closely, maybe every month, so that this a controlled speed can be maintained.
You run large companies which were great at offering services, great customer experiences. These are companies basically we had, which had great repeatable and predictable systems. If I go and see this, if I go and see the startup culture, there are a lot of ad hoc actions, ad hoc decisions which come, and they all say it's all basically startup culture. But ultimately, you know, if you want to create a great company, you have to have proper systems in which repeatable and predictable outcomes come. How do you create those?
To an outsider, you know, that looks that there is too much helter-skelter. But let me tell you, a founder and the leadership team of every startup is controlling that helter-skelter. They know what they're doing. They know what direction they are going. They know how changes are required and how fast changes are required. So I have closely followed many, many startups, and I'm supporting more than 20, 25 startups now. Now, number one most important thing is digitization. Digitization of the processes inside the company, within the company, within the organization, various functions, and digitization with all external stakeholders, whether they're dealers, distributors, customers, vendors. So once their digitization is end-to-end, then you see the speed of the company and repeatability and reliability of every process is very high. That's number one. Number two is that validation of all new products deeply, in the sense of so that their failure possibilities are close to zero. So product development process has to be far more repeatable, far more thorough and comprehensive, so that any failure can be caught early, any problem can be caught early rather than caught by a customer, so that customer's life can be made easy. The third aspect is training of employees. Employees have to be trained and retrained very, very extensively on this issue of repeatability, because it may sound a bit boring, that's okay, but it's so important for building a long-term brand and long-term business. The processes have to be very sound, so that whether the transactions are 1 million a day or 10 million a day, doesn't matter. The transactions are reliable, they all happen, the failure mode analysis is done very, very deeply, and there's a team which continuously works on customer experience enhancement. So companies who have this culture, and I'm definitely seeing many companies adopting this culture, I think they survive. Not only survive, they grow, keep on growing and outpacing their competition.
I think one of the key learnings which you can offer to this the startup culture is basically, how do you deal with regulators? All startups basically have, they struggle with this. I mean, you've done a lot of fighting with the regulators, you've worked with the regulators closely. How do you deal with that scenario? In which there is no playbook available in India.
There's no playbook globally. So regulation is a evolving issue across the world, especially pertaining to technology. All the countries, whether they're US, China, Japan, Europe, they're evolving new technology-based, AI-based, machine learning-based, and regulations which pertain to robots, pertain to drones, pertain to so many aspects which have not been there since in the last maybe 3 years or 5 years. So clearly, this is a new subject. And these founders are not used to any regulation. They aspire for a business which is completely free, and they decide on everything, which doesn't happen normally. So my advice to all founders and entrepreneurs is clearly that firstly, they should go for 100% compliance, not 99%. Compliance is culture is very important. And it is not about consumer satisfaction. It's also about financial compliance. It's also about vendor compliance. It's also about satisfaction of all your stakeholders, not for the sake of regulation, but for the sake of the reputation and brand of the company. I think that is more important than anything else. So that is one. Second is that helping the government with new regulations, because technology regulations are work in progress across the world.
Absolutely.
So working closely, collaborating with the government, departments or ministries, giving them feedback on what is happening in US, EU, Japan, and many other parts of the world, so that government also understands a global phenomenon. And if there's a best practice coming from US or EU or some other part of the world, that best practice can easily be picked up. We should not be shying away from picking up good ideas across the world. And the world will also pick up good ideas from India, because India is not behind the world now. In the digital technology era, India is on par with the world. What India is doing in regulations is on par, not behind, which is very good news, very big change compared to last 50 years. And therefore, I'm very happy to say that government is focusing on this. Many ministries and departments I deal with, they are focusing on this. I have been very, as I said, advising founders and entrepreneurs to work closely with government departments so that what comes out as a regulation or what changes happen, they're based on some logic. They're based on rationality. They're based on customer experience. They're based on national security. Whatever are important objectives for the country, those objectives are achieved. So I don't think these regulations are to stop any business. These regulations are to make business disciplined, make the growth systematic, safeguard the rights of the customers, whether they are privacy rights, whether they are data, personal data, non-personal data rights. So I believe that regulations are good. The only thing is with collaboration of the startups with the government, they'll become better and better.
I think we've run out of time. Thank you so much for doing it with us. It was a pleasure speaking with you.
Thank you, Vinod. I'm very happy to talk to you, and let's keep in touch.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Manoj and Vinod, thank you for the dialogue that you initiated as part of the final session in the track on what the startup founders need to be cognizant of as and when they aspire to scale up. And ladies and gentlemen, we are confident that today's day at hashtag ETGDL was absolutely worth it. While, as I would say that if you are a go-getter on the platform and you've explored all the features, thumbs up right there. And if you haven't till now, you may still do so. And once again, I would urge all of you to fill in the feedback form, especially at the partner booths right now, if you haven't, while exploring their technology showcases, just in case if you could not get a breather in between the back-to-back sessions and the tracks that we witnessed, of course, with the mammoth content that was being discussed amidst the leading speakers that joined us throughout the day. And of course, win some goodies and prizes as you fill in those feedback forms there. And yes, a good fight for the leaderboard seems to be still continuing, and I'm sure it will bear some good fruits. Some of you will emerge as winners and will be rewarded for your efforts as well. So stay tuned for that bit as well. Thank you all very much for participating in the Unicorns of India track at Amazon Internet Services Presents, the Economic Times Global Digital League 2.0, co-powered by Kindred. Well, before we sign off, I think it would be a fair idea to see what's latest from the Twitteratis, once they've used our hashtag right out there. So the latest that I see is some 8 minutes back, ET Global Digital League, very informative event that's coming from Subodh Fadnis. Thank you very much, Subodh. Glad you enjoyed. And All right, so this is something when RazorPay started in 2015, the cloud was developed enough for adoption. Thank you very much. So this is what you found striking in the last panel, of course, that we had. Thank you very much for all the love that has flown in the form of tweets and, of course, your understanding as you all joined us. I'm just scrolling through the tweets and it's absolutely heartening to know. And with that, keep the conversation still floating on social media using the hashtag ETGDL. And please remember to tag us as well. We would be absolutely delighted to retweet once you tag us. And with that, it's time to extend a warm gratitude to our presenting partner. Thank you so very much, Amazon Internet Services. Well, the summit is co-powered by Kyndryl. So Kyndryl, thank you to you all as well. The innovation partner being Dell Technologies, the platinum partners being NetApp and Reddington, our gold partners, thank you very much, Commvault, Juniper Networks, Exclusive Networks, Fiserv, Checkpoint Software Technologies, and of course, our associate partners, Polydata, Matics, and Jabra. Well, our supporting association, as you know, ladies and gentlemen, have been Commodity Participants Association of India, CPAI, Cyber Society of India, and National Accreditation Board for Hospitals, that is NABH. Well, I won't take much of your time now. Just want to say the biggest and the most heartfelt thank you to all of you, our dearest, dearest delegates. Thank you for making the second edition of ETGDL also a success and, of course, worthwhile at the same time. A big thank you on behalf of the ETH team. Enjoy the rest of the evening and stay tuned for our upcoming events as well. Thank you.